Clean air is something we all need. Still, there's a lot of air pollution here in Beijing. The city is notorious for its smog, but a politician can use his power as king of this jungle and enforce solutions. Also, that is proven here in Beijing, where skies can be blue, Olympic blue, APEC blue, and my favorite, ChemCon blue. And perhaps circular economy blue. But what is circular economy, and how can it help industry and society towards a more sustainable future? Interesting questions I will discuss today with Anne Tevelde, Councillor Infrastructure and Environment at the Embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands here in Beijing. Anne, how would you describe in short circular economy?
In short, I would describe it as not just recycling waste streams, but really producing new products from secondary material. So not just from virgin material, but from secondary feed. And also making these products recyclable again.
During the launch of the circular economy package in Europe, a statement was made that circular economy creates opportunities for the growth of the European chemical industry. What is your view on this?
Yes, I definitely believe that it will be creating opportunities for the chemical industry as well. But it's not a process that is reached overnight. It will take time because new business models are needed. New ideas about how to come to a circular process in the chemical sector instead of a linear process all takes a lot of time. But in the end, it will use less products, less energy, it will use renewable energy, so it will curb production cost. The companies that adapt these new business modes now are really the front runners and can in the end really benefit from it.
Circular economy is a very complex process where a lot of aspects need to be aligned, like economical, technical, political, legally, procurement aspects. Which of these aspects do you think are the most difficult to align?
I think the most important one to come to a circular economy is timing of new legislation, which allows for those front runners, which are now experiencing with all kinds of new business modes and investing in that, also take the benefit of these investments.
Okay, and based on your experience, what is the key aspect to accelerate the implementation of circular economy?
One is, of course, a sense of urgency of people, of companies that that feel that we have to go to other production modes. And then we share our examples, that we share best practices, that we have a possibility to and the means to learn from one another. So there also needs to be an environment in which the sharing is something that people and companies do.
How can organizations like, for instance, on the EU level accelerate then the legal system for circular economy?
Well, a good example from my own experience is that enforcement agencies throughout the European Union work together to come to the same level of enforcement of new rules and regulations. And also when new legislation is being developed, when new policies, new legislation is being developed, that they speak in an early stage with one another about enforcement means and modes of enforcement. How do we interpret new regulations?
For instance, at the EU level, they're considering to change the policy making for waste, to make waste as an option, as secondary feed, basically. That's a complex process, but it would help, of course, a circular economy to fly off to a new level if it works.
Definitely. And the thing about that is there is discussions now in the EU about this end of waste definition. When does a waste stream get the definition of end of waste so it can be used as a virgin material again, right? Yeah. And it's a complex and difficult process. Not for nothing that we once said these waste streams are waste, because you know they have to be treated in a proper manner in order not to pollute our environment. So you know, when can these streams be? What kind of treatment needs to be undergone by these streams in order to really make them safe to use in product processes again? production processes again, which is it's complicated. And it's, I think what is done now, it is piloting with this concept and with different waste streams to see how can they when are they good enough to be used again. This piloting is very important, yeah. And this should be done throughout the European Union and maybe even throughout the world.
Do you see some good practices in EU member states that can bridge the differences in the approaches for circular economy?
Yeah, for example, I see a very specific example is the North Sea Resources Roundabout, which is a platform in which the Netherlands, Belgium, UK, Germany and France are working together to cater for cross-border supply chain of waste streams, of recyclable streams. It's one of the examples that works very well. Another one is the initiatives that are now taking place in the Horizon 2020 program, in which countries also work together to disseminate best practices.
What kind of circular economy practices do you see here in China?
You see the design of very modern industrial parks where industrial symbiosis takes place, where one factory uses the waste streams of the other one again in its production process. And because they are designed from scratch, it is also easier maybe to do compared with Europe. On the one hand, there are very highly sophisticated examples. On the other hand, I mean, you see the waste in Beijing. There's a lot to be done.
And did you already notice one particular example here in China that you'd say, hey, we should implement something similar in Europe?
Yeah, I've been to do some of the industrial parks which are designed now, and I think also some of the European countries working with them say that or see that this kind of, you know, really designing new parks is a way to come easier to the circular processes that we need in production. On a very different level, you have all these shared economy examples here in Beijing. For example, everybody sees the bicycles now that people use, share. More and more companies, I think China is can be a front runner in that. Look at these modes, not just thinking about products, but thinking about services they can give to consumers. And these services, if they use, for example, cycling as a service, and the bike is just a means and it keeps in the possession of a company, the company makes sure that it's a good and sturdy bike. Because it's their own asset, right? And they have to take care of that. And the better it is, the longer they can use it, and the cheaper their service will be again. So there's a lot of economic gain in that. Another example is, of course, our own company, Philips Lighting. Giving light now as a service, so not just selling the bulbs, but selling light, and very interesting concept that are really taking off.
Anna, thank you very much for the interview. We can conclude that with the right legal framework and mindset, industry can manufacture end products with the same high quality standards from secondary feed. In that way, we can limit the use of virgin feed and get a step closer to closing the loopholes in the circle of life of our planet.